I'm Gintaras Duda. I'm the professor of physics here at Creighton University. And starting in the fall, I'll also be the holder of the A.F. Jacobson Endowed Chair in Communication with a focus on science communication, which is why I'm excited to be here today.
I have a deeply personal connection with volleyball. I come from a volleyball family, so my sister played for Notre Dame. My brother actually coaches right now for University of Providence in Great Falls, Montana. And I grew up playing volleyball, so I lived in Southern California growing up. We would go out to the Manhattan Beach Open, you know, Seal Beach Open. We watched, you know, sand volleyball. We watched a lot of volleyball. My parents still, this day and age, you call them, if anything else, they're watching volleyball. So it's pretty amazing. But volleyball also figures in kind of one of my other great loves in life, which is physics. And it's amazing watching the amount of physics that's in volleyball, something you may not think of right away. But I mean, physics surrounds us. It controls everything that we do. Controls what we can and can't do. I mean, physics is just part of life. And so the amount of physics and the biomechanics that goes into volleyball is just amazing. And if you want to see physics and volleyball done really, really well, then one of the best places to look would be Creighton, you know, women's volleyball team, who's an amazing, amazing team. I mean, they had an amazing season last year. It was wonderful. It was so much fun watching them get to the Elite Eight. So here I am as a physicist and a volleyball enthusiast, and I'm going to help you break down kind of the physics of the set and then the volleyball kill, right? All the components of that. But the Creighton women are amazing, almost sort of implicit physicists, right? Or sort of, they're doing physics without knowing it, right? So they're applying all these things their coaches have taught them, they learned playing the game, all these fundamentals that are really based in physics, based in biomechanics, to really help them be that successful.
So in volleyball, right, obviously to get a point, get a kill, right, it all really starts with the set. You know, just like with anything with sport, there's a lot of technicals, there's a lot of technical aspects, but there's a lot of chemistry that goes into it as well. So a setter has to work with their hitter, right? They really wanna, you know, the setter needs to put the ball in a place where the hitter can attack it, right, and get that point for their team. So it starts with the set, and you know, thinking about with the set, probably the most important thing with a set is just placement. Where is that set going to be? Because if the ball's in the right place, then the hitter has options. So for example, if the ball's too far outside, then you've got the antenna, which is kind of the hard boundary. You can't hit outside that. That limits kind of the scope of, you know, the sort of field where you can hit the ball. But a good set puts the ball in a place where it's going to advantage the hitter and it's going to disadvantage the blockers. A lot of it is really just chemistry. It's kind of reading, you know, knowing what your hitter, what kind of time they need, where they like the ball, and everyone's a little different. I think that's one of the great things about Creighton's volleyball team, watching those women play. They've got this great chemistry where they kind of know, they understand each other, they know what they need, what they like to make themselves successful. After the set, right, the hitter's going to come up, they're going to do their approach, they're going to hit the ball. Big aspect of that, or probably the most important things, is the jump, right? You got to get up there. The higher you get, the more options you have, going over the block, going around the block. So jumping is such a fundamental aspect of volleyball, much like it is in other sports like basketball. So what happens when the volleyball hitter goes to jump? So one of the things you'll notice is, first of all, they're gonna kind of crouch down, they're gonna swing their arms and bring them up. So I always tell my physics students, we get into this kind of silly example of, you know, pendulum, like your arms are like pendulums. And so when you run, you keep your arms bent. And so you go like this. I tell my students, try running with your arms straight by your side. It's one of the most awkward things you can possibly do because it just doesn't, like, the timing doesn't work out. So the momentum from your arm swing, the momentum of your arms gets transferred to your body. Second thing you'll notice is that they crouch down. And so the reason why they crouch down is because this is a simple kind of Newton's third law kind of thing, right? Newton's third law says every action is equal and opposite reaction. The idea is the volleyball player exerts a force on the ground. The ground exerts that force back on the volleyball player. That's what propels them upwards, allows them to kind of, you know, jump up in the air. And the idea is that if you crouch down, the longer you crouch down, the longer you're in contact with the floor, the longer that force can get exerted on you, which translates to more time to, you know, to basically build up a higher velocity. And so what you find is it's a competition between the hitters and the blockers. And the blockers, technically, right, can't swing their arms quite as well because, well, imagine you're standing, the net's right in front of you here, you swing your arms, what happens? Boom, you're in the net. The blockers either have to turn to the side, kind of swing this way and kind of come up, which is a little more awkward, or even just going straight up. But the outside hitter who's doing their approach with kind of a 3 or 4 step kind of approach can actually get a little taller than them. So they've got an advantage. Plus, they're impacting the ball, they're hitting the ball right up here above their head. So the idea is that the higher you hit the ball, right, then, like I said, the more options you have. And so the jumping is a huge aspect of that. And what's amazing, if you look at NCAA kind of recruiting guidelines, you know, the vertical jump for Division I athletes like we have at Creighton is pretty amazing, right? So after the set, the volleyball player does their approach, right, 3 or 4 steps, arms go down, they jump, they come up, right? Notice the arms are coming up. And so very natural thing to do is to have the left arm up if you're a right-handed hitter. Your left arm's gonna kind of track the ball. So it kind of helps the brain just to have that ball kind of in the hand, the same visual frame of reference. And then that right arm comes back, come through, right? Ball gets contact, hopefully at the highest point
of the swing. So what goes on there is the faster you can swing your arm, obviously the faster that's going to translate into the, you know, a faster kill, right? We like to teach physics by using simple analogies, and it's kind of like the physics of a merry-go-round, right? So the kind of thing we all played with and rode on as kids. And the idea is that a merry-go-round is the whole thing's turning, right? It's got an angular speed, in another sense, that it takes so much time to go around. And the whole merry-go-round goes around in that same time period. But any other single given point on the merry-go-round is actually moving with a different, what we call a linear speed. And you can feel this, right, sitting in a merry-go-round next time you're out there, you know, playing a merry-go-round or pushing your kids or whatever it might be. It feels very different to be sitting in the center than sitting on the outside. So those outside points, because they have to go around a larger circle in the same amount of time, are actually moving at a much, much faster rate of speed. And that's kind of the same thing with the arm, right? As the arm goes through, you swing with your arm, the end of your arm is moving much, much faster than the middle of your arm or your shoulder, for example. That faster arm movement, the faster hand movement, then translates into a faster impact with the volleyball. So that, in a nutshell, is the physics of the volleyball kill. So hopefully you've learned a little something here and are a little more interested. And pay attention to these things. So next time you come to one of our amazing Creighton women's volleyball games, check out and watch what these great athletes do. Watch the set, watch the jump, right, the mechanics there, watch the swing, see all that goes into play there.